On November 14th, 1998, members of the Tectonic Theater Project traveled to Laramie, Wyoming to conduct interviews with members of the town. Over the course of the next year, we would return many times, ultimately conducting over 200 interviews. The play you are about to see is edited from those interviews, as well as from journal entries by members of the company and other found texts. Company member Greg Pirotti.
My first interview was with the Detective Sergeant Hing of the Laramie Police Department. At the start of the interview, he was sitting behind his desk like this.
I was born and raised here. My family is a third generation. My grandparents moved here in the early 1900s. We've had basically three, well, my daughter makes it fourth generation. Quite a while. It's a good place to live. Good people, lots of space. Now, all the towns in southern Wyoming are laid out in space because a railroad came through. It was how far they could go before having to refuel and rewater. And the Laramie was a major stopping point. That's why the towns are spaced so far apart. We're one of the largest states in the country, and the least populated.
There's so much space between people here, so much time for reflection.
Rebecca Hilliker, head of the theater department at the University of Wyoming.
You have an opportunity to be happy in your life here. You know, I found the people here were nicer than they were in the Midwest where I used to teach. Well, because they were happier. They liked the sun. The sun was always shining, and it really does shine a lot here.
What you have is you have your old-time traditional rancher types, and they've been here forever. Laramie's been the hub of where they come for their supplies and stuff like that.
Stewardship is one thing that all our ancestors taught us.
Eileen Engen, rancher.
If you don't take care of the land, then you ruin it and you lose your living. So you first of all have to take care of your land and do everything you can to improve it.
I love it here.
Doc O'Connor, limousine driver.
You couldn't put me back in that mess out there back east. Best thing about it is the climate. They say the Wyoming wind will drive a man insane, but you know what? It doesn't bother me. Well, some of the times it bothers me, but most of the time it don't.
And then you got the the university population.
I moved here after living in a couple of big cities.
Philip Dubois, president of the University of Wyoming.
I loved it there, but you'd have to be out of your mind to let your kids out after dark. And here, in the summertime, my kids play out till 11 o'clock at night, and I don't think twice about it.
And then you have the people who live in Laramie, basically.
I moved here from rural Texas.
Zachy Salmon, Laramie resident.
Now, in Laramie, if you don't know someone, you will definitely know someone they know, so it can only be 1 degree removed at most. And I mean, I love it. I mean, I love going out to the grocery store because I get to visit with 4 or 5 or 6 different people. And I mean, I don't really mind people knowing my business, because what's my business? My business is basically good.
I like the trains, too. They don't bother me. Well, some of the times they bother me, but most of the times they don't. Even though one goes by every 13 minutes out where I live.
Doc actually lives up in Bosler, but everyone in Laramie knows him. He also really isn't a doctor.
They used to carry cattle, them trains, but now all they really carry is diapers and cars.
I grew up in Cody, Wyoming.
April Silva, university student.
Laramie's better than where I grew up, I'll give it that.
It's a good place to live. Good people, lots of space. Now, when the incident happened with that boy, a lot of press people came here. And one time, some of them followed me up to the crime scene, and, well, it was just a beautiful day, absolutely gorgeous, you know, real clear and crisp. And the sky was that kind of blue that you would just never be able to paint it, you know, it was just sky blue, absolutely gorgeous. And the mountains in the background, a little snow on them, and this one reporter lady, she says to me,
"Well, who found the boy? Who was out here anyway?"
And I said, "Well, this is a really popular area for people to run, and mountain biking's really big out here. horseback riding. It's just, well, you know, it's close to town. And she said...
Well, who in the hell would run out here?
I'm thinking, lady, you're missing the point, you know? You're just missing the point. You know, all you gotta do is turn around and see the mountains. Smell the air, listen to the birds. Just take in what's around you. And they were just nothing but the story. I didn't feel judged by them. I thought they were just stupid. I mean, they were missing the point. They were just missing the whole point.
It's hard to talk about Laramie now, to tell you what Laramie is for us.
Jedediah Schultz.
If you would have asked me before, I would have told you that Laramie is a beautiful town, a secluded enough where you can have your own identity, a town with a strong sense of community. Everyone knows everyone. A town with a personality most larger cities are stripped of. Now, after Matthew, Laramie's become a town defined by an accident, a crime. We've become Waco, we've become Jasper, we've become a noun, a definition, a sign, and we may be able to change all of that, but it will sure take a while.
Journal entries. Members of the company. Andy Paris.
Moisés called saying he had an idea for his next theater project, but there was a somberness to his voice, so I asked what it was about, and he said he wanted to do a piece about the events happening in Wyoming.
Stephen Belber.
Lee told me the company was thinking of going out to Laramie to conduct interviews and that they wanted me to come. I'm hesitant. I have no real interest in prying into a town's unraveling.
Amanda Brunich.
I've never done anything like this before in my entire life. How do you get people to talk to you? What do you ask?
Moisés Kaufman.
The company has agreed that we would go to Laramie for a week and interview people. I'm a bit afraid about taking 10 people on a trip of this nature, so we have to have some safety rules. Nobody works alone. Everybody carries a cell phone. I've made some preliminary contacts with Rebecca Hilliker, who's the head of the theater department at the University of Wyoming. She's hosting a party for us on our first night in Laramie and has promised to introduce us to possible interviewees.
Let's tell you, when I first heard that you were coming here, when you first called me, I wanted to say that you have kicked me in the stomach. Why are you doing this to me? And then I thought, well, that's stupid. I mean, you're not doing it to me. Well, more importantly, I thought about it and I decided that, well, we've had so much negative closure here, this whole thing. Well, the students really need to talk. I mean, when this happened, they started talking about it, and then the media descended and all dialogue stopped. You know, I really love my students, and, well, they're free thinkers. You know, they have a lot to say. You may not like what they have to say, but they're honest. And they're truthful. So there's an excitement here. But there's a dynamic here, you know, that my students had that I never had in the Midwest or in North Dakota where I used to teach. Because there was so much Puritanism that dictated really how people looked at the world. A lot of the times, well, they didn't have an opinion. You couldn't get them to express an opinion. And quite honestly, I would rather have an opinion that I don't like and have that dynamic in education. You know, there's a student I think you should talk to. His name is Jedediah Schultz.
I've lived in Wyoming my whole life. The family's been in Wyoming, well, for generations. Now, when it came time to go to college, I knew that my parents couldn't afford to send me to go to college. I wanted to study theater. And I knew that if I was going to go to college, then I was going to have to get in on a scholarship. So they have this competition each year, this Wyoming State High School competition, and, well, I knew that if I didn't get first place in the duets, that I wasn't going to get a scholarship. So I went to the university, the theater department at the university, looking for a good scene, and I asked one of the professors there. I was like, I need a killer scene. And he was like, all right, here you go. And it was from Angels in America. So I read it, and I knew that I could win best scene if I did a good enough job. And when the time came, I told my parents so that they would be able to come and see me in the competition. Now, you have to understand something. My parents come to everything. Every ball game, every hockey game, everything I've ever done. And they brought me in their room and they told me that if I did that scene, that they would not come and see me in the competition.
because they thought that it was wrong, that homosexuality is wrong, and they felt that strongly about it that they wouldn't come see their own son do probably the most important thing he had done up to that point in his life. I didn't know what to do. I have never, ever gone against my parents' wishes. So I was kind of worried about it. But I decided to do it. And all I can remember from the competition is that when we were done, me and my scene partner, we came up to each other and we shook each other's hands, and there was a standing ovation. Oh, man, it was amazing. And we won, and I got first place, and that's how come I can afford to be here at the university, because of that scene. It was one of the proudest moments of my life. My parents weren't there to see it. And to this day, that is the one thing that my parents have not seen me do. And thinking back on it, I think, why did I do it? Why did I oppose my parents? Because I'm not gay, so then why did I do it? And, well, the only honest answer I can come up with is, well, I wanted to win. Oh, man, it was such a good scene. It's like the best scene. Do you know Mr. Kushner? Maybe you can tell him for me.
Company member Greg Parati.
We arrived today at the Denver airport and drove to Laramie. As we crossed over the Wyoming border, I swear I saw a herd of buffalo. And I thought it was kind of strange that the Wyoming sign said,
Wyoming, like no place on earth.
Instead of Wyoming, like no place else on earth.
Company member Lee Fondikowski.
I stopped at the local inn for a bite to eat, and my waitress said to me,
Hi, my name is Debbie, and I was born in 1954. And Debbie Reynolds was big back then, so yes, there are a lot of us around. But I promise I won't slap you if you leave your elbows on the table.
Today, the company tried to explain to me what chicken fried steak was.
Now, are you from Wyoming, or are you just passing through?
We're just passing through.
Company member Barbara Pitts.
We arrived in Laramie tonight, just past the Welcome to Laramie sign, population 26,687. The first thing to greet us was Walmart. In the dark, we could be on any main drag in America, fast food chains, gas stations. But as we drove into the downtown area by the railroad tracks, the buildings still looked like a turn of the century Western town. Oh, and as we passed by the University Inn, on the sign where amenities such as cable TV or heated pool are usually touted, it said, hate is not a Laramie value.
Greg Prine.
I met today with two longtime Laramie residents, Allison Mears and Marge Murray, two social service workers who taught me a thing or two.
Well, what Laramie used to be like when Marge was growing up, well, it was mostly rural.
Yeah, it was. I enjoyed it, you know. My kids all had horses.
Well, there was more land. I mean, you could keep your pet cow, your horses, your little chickens. You could just have your little bit of acreage.
Yeah. I could run around the house in my all-togethers, do the housework while the kids are in school, and nobody could see me. And if they got that close...
Then that's their problem.
I just want to make sure I got the expression right. In your all-togethers?
Well, yeah, honey, why wear clothes?
Who's going to use that in this play?
I don't know.
So this is a big ranching town?
Oh, no, not just ranching. This was a big railroad town at one time, before they moved everything to Cheyenne and Omaha and Green River. What was it, even in the 50s?
Oh,
well, they had this one big roundhouse that had such a complete shop they could build a complete whole engine.
They did. My mom worked there.
What, your mom worked in a roundhouse?
Yep. She washed engines. Her name was Mitty. We used to, you know, sing that song to her. You know that song.
What song?
Run for the roundhouse, Mitty. They can't corner you there.
I'll tell you, Wyoming is bad in terms of jobs. Mm. The university has the big high whoop-de-doo jobs, but in Wyoming, unless you're a professional, most of the people are hard-working, minimum-wage jobs.
Yeah. I've been either in the service industry or bartending most of my life. Now, I know everybody in town.
And she does.
And I do. Now, then I'll tell you, here in Laramie, there is a difference, and there always has been. What it is a class distinction. It's about the well-educated and the ones that are not. And the ones that are educated can't understand why the other ones don't want to get educated. That's why I told you before my kids had a fight because their mother was a bartender. Never mind, I was the best damn bartender in town.
And she was.
That's not bragging, that's a fact.
But here in Laramie, if it weren't for the university, we'd be SOL.
What's SOL?
Say it. Well, shit out of luck. Oh, Lordy, you got that there on your tape. Boy, are you getting an education today.
Yeah, I guess I am. Let me just ask you, what was your response when this happened to Matthew Shepard?
I've been close enough to the case to know many of the people. I have a daughter that's on the sheriff's department. As far as the gay issue, I don't give a damn one way or the other, as long as they don't bother me. And even if they did, I'd just say no thank you. And that's the attitude of most of the Laramie population, that they might poke one if they were in a bar situation, you know? If they've been drinking, they might actually smack one across the mouth. But then they just walk away. Most of them said that they would say, I don't swing that way, and whistle on about their business. Laramie is live and let live.
I'd say that Marge knows even more than she's even willing to say, and we have to respect her for that.
Willow, where are you going with this story?
we still haven't decided yet, actually. When we're finished, we're going to try to take it around to Laramie.
Okay, well, then there are parts that I am not going to tell you.
Company member Andy Paris.
Today, for the first time, we met someone who actually knew Matthew Shepard. Tris Steger, owner of a shop in town, referred to him as Matt.
Matt used to come into my shop. That's how I know.
It was the first time I heard him referred to as Matt instead of Matthew. Did he go by Matt to everyone?
Well, on the 2nd of October, I get a phone call about 10 after 7.
Doc O'Connor.
It was Matthew Shepard. And he said, can you pick me up on the corner of 3rd and Grand? So anyhow, I pull up to the corner to see who Matthew Shepard, and it's this little guy, about 5'2", soaking wet, I bet you 97 pounds. They said he was 110, but I wouldn't believe it. And then the newspaper also said he was 5'5", but this kid was 5'1", maybe 5'2". Anyway, so he walks up to the window, and I say, are you Matthew Shepard? And he says, yeah, I'm Matthew Shepard, but I don't want you to call me Matthew. I don't want you to call me Mr. Shepard. I don't want you to call me anything. My name is Matt. And I want you to know that I'm gay, and we're going to a gay bar. You have a problem with that? And I just said, how you paying? The fact is, Laramie doesn't have any gay bars. For that matter, neither does Wyoming. So he was hiring me to take him down to Fort Collins, Colorado, about an hour away. Matt was a blunt little shit, you know what I'm saying? He always was, that's why I liked him. He was really straightforward. Maybe gay, but straightforward.
I don't know, you know? I mean, how does one person tell about another? You should really talk to my sister, Romaine. She was a very good friend of Matthew's.
We never called him Matthew, actually. Most of the time, we called him Choo Choo. Because, you know, we used to call him Matt Shoe, and then that just became Choo-Choo. And whenever I think of Matthew, I just picture his incredible, beaming smile. I mean, he'd just walk into a room and be like... You know what I mean? And he just made me feel great. He'd smile at everyone. And when I was working in the coffee shop, he always used to want to sit in that corner seat so he could talk to me while I was working. And if somebody was sitting in that seat, he'd walk on over there and stare at him. Until they left. Then he claimed the spot. But Matt definitely had a political side to him. I mean, he was really interested in political affairs. That's all his big interest was watching CNN and MSNBC. I mean, those are the only stations I ever saw as TV tuned into. Matt was really, really smart when it came to political type things, but not too smart when it came to common sense type things. So he moves to Laramie to go to school.
Matthew was very shy when he first came in.
John Peacock, Matthew Shepard's academic advisor.
To the point of being somewhat mousy, I'd almost say. He was having some difficulty adjusting, but this was home for him, and he made it quite clear. And so his mousiness, his shyness, gave way to a person who was excited about this track that he was going to embark on. He was just figuring out, wanting to work on human rights, how he's going to do that. And when that happens, this person begins to bloom a little bit. He was starting to say, wow, there are opportunities here. There are things I can do in this world. I can be important.
I did hear from Matt about 48 hours before his attack, and he said he just joined the gay and lesbian group on campus and that he was really enjoying it. You know, they were getting ready for Pride Week and whatnot. Matt was totally stoked about school. Yeah, he was really happy about being there.
And in retrospect, and I can only say this in retrospect, of course, I think that's where he was heading, towards human rights, which only adds to the irony and the tragedy of this.
Let me tell you something else here. There's more gay people in Wyoming than meets the eye. I know for a fact. They're not particularly, what do you call them, the queens, the gay people, the queens, the run around like faggoty type people. No, they're the ones that throw bale and hay and jump on horses and brand them and kick ass, you know what I'm saying? As I always say, never fuck with a Wyoming queer, because they will kick you in your fucking ass. That's not exactly the point I'm trying to make. The point I'm trying to make here is that I know a lot of gay people in Wyoming. I know a lot of people, period. I've lived here for some 40-odd years. And I don't think people in Wyoming give a damn if you're gay or straight. It doesn't matter. If there's 8 men and 1 woman in a Wyoming bar, which is often the case, you gotta stop and think, who's getting what? Oh, geez, it doesn't take a big intelligent mind to figure that one out.
My understanding when I first came here...
Catherine Connolly.
Because I was the first outdoor gay faculty member on campus, and that was in 1992, so it wasn't that long ago. I was asked what my husband did in my interview, and so I came out then. Do you want to know a funny story? When you first get here as a new faculty member on campus, there's all these things you have to do. And so I'm in my office, and I noticed this woman called. And I thought it was a health insurance phone call, something like that, and so I called her back. And I could hear her. She's typing away on her keyboard. And I said, hi, this is Kathy Connolly calling, returning your phone call. And she said, oh, it's you. And I thought, this is bizarre. And she says, I hear you're gay, I hear you are. And I was like, uh-huh. And she said, I hear you came as a couple. I am one too, not a couple, just a person. And so she was a kind of lesbian who knew I was coming and wanted to come and meet me immediately. And then she later told me that there were other lesbians who wouldn't be seen with me, that I would irreparably taint them, that to be seen with me could be a problem.
When I came here, I knew it was going to be hard as a gay man.
Jonas Sloanica.
But I kept telling myself, people should just live where they want to live. And there would be times I would go down to Denver and I would go to gay bars. And people would ask where I was from and I'd say Laramie, Wyoming. And I met so many men down there from Wyoming, so many gay men who grew up here. And they're like, this is not a place where I can live. How can you live there? I had to get out. But every once in a while, there'd be a guy. Oh gosh, I miss Laramie. I mean, I really love it there. And that's where I want to live. And they get this starry-eyed look in their eye, and I'm like, if that's where you want to live, then do it. I mean, imagine if more gay people stayed in small towns, but it's easier said than done, of course.
Today we're moving from our motel and heading for the Best Western.
Moisés Kaufman.
My hope is that it's at least a better Western.
Amanda Brunich.
Today we divided up to go to different churches in the community. Moisés and I were given a Baptist church. We were welcomed into the service by the Reverend himself, standing at the entrance to the chapel. This is what I remember of his sermon that morning.
My dear brothers and sisters, I am here today to bring you the word of the Lord. Now I have a simple truth that I tell to my colleagues, and I am going to tell it to you today. The word is either sufficient or it is not. Scientists tell me that human history, that the world, is 5 billion or 6 billion years old. After all, what's a billion years, give or take? The Bible tells me that human history is 6,000 years old. The word is either sufficient or it is not.
Ah, the sociology of religion in the West.
Stephen Mead Johnson, Unitarian minister.
Dominant religious traditions in this town, Baptist, Mormon, they're everywhere. It's not just Salt Lake, you know, they're all over. They're like jam on toast down here.
The Mormon church has a little different thing going that irritates some folks.
Doug Laws, stake ecclesiastical leader for the Mormon church.
And that's that we absolutely believe that God still speaks to man. We don't think that it happened and some folks wrote it in the Bible. God speaks to us today. We believe that. We believe the prophet of the church has the authority to receive inspiration and revelation from God.
So the spectrum would be, on the left side of that panel, so far left that I am probably all by myself, is me. And the Unitarian Church. Unitarians are by and large humanists, many of whom are atheists. I mean, we're not even sure we're a religion, actually. And, well, to my right on the spectrum, to his credit, Father Roger, Catholic priest, who is well established here. And God bless him, he did not equivocate at all when this happened. He hosted the vigil for Matthew that night.
I was really jolted because, you know, when we did the vigil, we wanted to get other ministers involved, and we called some of them, but they weren't going to get involved. It was like, we're going to stand back and wait and see which way the wind is blowing. And that angered me immensely. We are supposed to stand out as leaders. I thought, wow, what's going on here?
God has set boundaries. And one of our responsibilities is to learn. What is it that God wants? So you study scripture and you look to your leaders. Then you know what the bounds are. Now once you know what the bounds are, then you get a feeling for what's out of bounds. There's a proclamation that came out on the family. A family is defined as one man, one woman, and children. That is a family. That's about as clear as you can state it. There is no sexual deviation in the Mormon church. No leniency. We just think it is out of bounds.
I warn you, you will be mocked. You will be ridiculed for the singularity of your faith. But you let the Bible be your guide. It's in there. It's all in there.
The Christian pastors, many of the conservative ones, were silent on this. Conservative Christians use the Bible to show the rest of the world, it says here in the Bible. And most Americans believe, and they do, that the Bible is the Word of God. And how are you going to fight that?
I am a biblicist, which means the Bible doesn't need me to be true. The Bible is true whether I believe it or not. The Word is either sufficient or it is not.
I arrived in Laramie on September 15th. I looked around, tumbleweed, cement factories, and I said to myself, what in the hell am I doing in Wyoming? 3 weeks later, I found out what in the hell I'm doing in Wyoming.
I had breakfast this morning with a university student named Zubeda Ula. She's an Islamic feminist who likes to do things her own way.
I've lived in Laramie since I was 4. Yeah. My parents are from Bangladesh. 2 years ago, because I'm Muslim, I decided to start wearing a scarf. Yeah, that's really changed my life in Laramie. Like, people say things to me like, why do you have to wear that thing on your head? Like, when I'm in the grocery store, I'm not looking to give people Islam 101. You know what I mean? So I'll be like, well, it's a part of my religion. And this is the worst part, because they'll be like, well, I know it's a part of your religion, but why? And it's, supposed to go into the full doctrine of physical modesty, my own spiritual relationship to the Lord, standing there with my pop and chips? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
You know, it's so unreal to me that, yeah, that a group from New York would be writing a play about Laramie. And then I was picturing, like, you're going to be in a play about my town. You're going to be on stage in New York pretending like you're us. It's going to be so weird.
Hello?
Yes, hello. My name is Amanda Gronich, and I'm here in Laramie working with the theater company. I went to the Reverend, your husband's church on Sunday, and I was extremely interested in talking with him about, like, the Reverend and some of his thoughts about these events.
I really don't think he'll want to talk to you. Well, he has very biblical views about their homosexuality. Doesn't condone that kind of behavior. Doesn't condone that kind of lifestyle or violence, you know what I mean? He was bombarded by the press when this whole thing happened, and the media has just been terrible about the whole thing.
Oh, I know. I really understand. It must have just been terrible.
Yes. Well, I think we were all just hoping it would go away.
Well, do you think maybe I could call back and speak with your husband just briefly?
All right. I guess you could call back around 9 o'clock.
Oh, thank you so much. I'll do that.
Today, Barbara and I went to the Fireside Bar, which is the last place Matthew was seen in public.
The Fireside definitely feels like a college bar, with a couple of pool tables and a stage area for karaoke night. Still, the few regulars in the bar in the afternoon definitely were not the college crowd.
First person we talked to was Matt Mickelson, the owner.
My great-great-grandfather moved here in 1862. He owned Laramie's first opera house. It was called Old Blue Front. And in 1870, Grandma Louisa Swain cast the first woman's ballot in any free election in the world. And that's why Wyoming is the equality state. So what I want to do is reestablish my bar business as Old Blue Front Opera House and Good Time Emporium. You know, I want to have a restaurant, I want to have a gift shop and a pool hall and do all this shit. You know, every night's ladies' night. So, the Fireside is the first step toward Old Blue Front Opera House and Good Time Emporium.
So, what about the night Matthew Shepard was here?
We had karaoke that night, 20, 30 people here. Matthew Shepard came in sitting right where you're sitting, just hanging out. I mean, if you want to talk to somebody, you should talk to Matt Galloway. He was the kid that was bartending that night. You'd have to meet him. His character speaks for itself. Hey, is Galloway bartending tonight?
Okay. We'll make this brief. Quick, we get it over with, and it will be everything. Just the facts. Here we go. 10 o'clock, I clock in. Usual time, Tuesday nights, 10:30. Matthew Shepard walks in, alone, sits down, orders a Heineken.
Belber, friend of Matthew Shepard.
Matt liked to drink Heineken and nothing else. Heineken, even though it cost $9.50 for a six-pack. He'd always buy the same beer.
So what can I tell you about Matt? Well, if you had 100 customers like him, it would be the best bar I've ever been in. And nothing to do with sexual orientation. Absolute mannerisms. Manners, politeness, intelligence. Always taking care of me, as in tips. Very nicely dressed, clean cut. You know, most people, they come in, they're pleased, they're thank you, they offer polite conversation, but within their vocabulary. So anyway, he kicks it there, doesn't seem to have a care in the world, or even that he's looking for anybody, just hoping to enjoy his drink and the company around. So then approximately 11:45, Aaron McKinney and Russell Henderson come in. I didn't know their names at first, but they're the accused, the perps, the accused. Anyway, they walk in, they're very stone-faced, dirty, grungy, rude, like gimme, that sort of thing. Anyway, they walk up to the bar and they paid for their pitcher in dimes and quarters, which, you don't forget something like that. Do not forget that. $5.50 in dimes and quarters. It's a bartender's nightmare. Now anyway, Henderson and McKinney, they didn't seem like intoxicated at all or anything like that. They came in, they ordered the beer, they took it back to the pool room, and they pretty much kept it themselves. Next thing I knew, probably about a half hour later, Henderson and McKinney are walking around, no beer. And I remember thinking to myself, I'm not going to ask them if they want another one, because they just paid for that one in dimes and quarters. Pretty safe bet they don't have any more money.
Romaine Patterson.
Money meant nothing to Matthew because he came from a lot of it. And he would like hand over his wallet in 2 seconds because it meant nothing. His shoes might have meant something. They can say it was a robbery. I don't buy it for even an iota of a second.
Then a few moments later, I look over and Aaron and Russell were talking to Matthew Shepard.
Aaron said that a guy walked up to him and said that he was gay and wanted to get with Aaron and Russ. Kristen Price, girlfriend of Aaron McKinney. And that he got aggravated with it and told him that he was straight and didn't want anything to do with him and walked off. He said that is when he and Russell went to the bathroom and decided to pretend that they were gay and get him in a truck and rob him.
Okay. No. They stated that Matt approached them, that he came on to them. I absolutely, positively refute that statement 100%. Refute it, and I'll give you 2 reasons why, okay? Number one, character reference. Why would he approach them? Why them? He wasn't approaching anybody else at the bar. They say he's gay, like flaming gay, and he's gonna come on to them? Bullshit. He wasn't coming on to anybody else. He didn't come on to me, hello? He's gonna come on to them? I don't believe it. And two, territorialism. It's the word I would use for this. It's just the fact that Matt was sitting there. Russell and Aaron were in the pool area, and upon their first interaction, they were talking to Matt in the area that Matt had been seeing all night. So who approached who by that?
But Matt was the kind of person, like, he would never not talk to somebody for any reason. If somebody started up a conversation with him, he'd just be like, oh, yeah, blah, 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 you know? He never had a problem striking up a conversation with anybody.
Matt did feel lonely a lot of times. Me knowing that and knowing how gullible Matt could be, he would have walked right into it. The fact that he was at the bar alone made him all that more vulnerable.
So the only thing is, and this is what I'm testifying to, because I'm basically the key eyewitness in this case, what I'm testifying to is that I saw Matthew leave. I saw 2 individuals leave with Matthew. I didn't see their faces, but I saw the back of their heads. And at the same time, McKinney and Henderson were no longer in the bar. You do the math.
Actually, I think the DJ was the last one to talk to him on his way out that night. Gave him a cigarette or something. His name is Shadow.
I was the last person that Matt talked to before he left the fireside. I was just pushing around with shit, and he stopped me. Well, I stopped him, actually. And he's like, hey, Shadow, da-da-da-da-da. And I was like, what, man? You getting ready to leave? And he's like, yeah, man. And this and that. And then I noticed them 2 guys. They stood outside. You could see it. You could see it. They were standing there, you know, and they was looking back over to him, and they were looking back at him, and I just stood, and I talked to Matt for like a good 10 minutes, and you seen these guys, they were getting worried and like anxious and shit. So when they took off, I seen it. They took off in a black truck, a small black truck, and the 3 of them sat in the front, and Matt in the middle. And I didn't think nothing of it, you know? I didn't figure them guys were gonna be like that.
A friend of Aaron McKinney.
I've known Aaron a long time. Aaron was a good kid. I liked Aaron a lot. That's why I was shocked when I heard of this. I'm like, he was living out far at his trailer house, is what he told me, with his girl. They just started dating last summer. They must have gotten pregnant real soon because they had a kid. He was 21 years old, running around with a kid. You see, he was the kind of... Aaron was like... He liked dressing in big clothes, you know, like Tommy Hilfiger... Polo, Gucci. At the time I knew him, he was just a young kid trying to fit in. You know, acting tough, acting cool, you know. But if you get in his face about something, he just back down. Just some kind of scared kid.
Sherry Engelson.
Oh, Russell. He was just so sweet. He was the one who was the Eagle Scout. His whole presence, it was just quiet and sweet. Of course, it doesn't make any sense at all to me. And I know people snap and whatever, and it wasn't like an intimate relationship. I was just his landlord. Well, I did work at the chuck wagon with him too, but, you know, I remember the Christmas party. He was totally drunk out of his mind, and, well, we were all pretty much party time, but, well, he wasn't belligerent. I mean, he didn't change his personality. It didn't change or anything. He was still the same meek, mild Russell, you know? I remember him coming up to me that night and he said, when you get a chance, Sherry, can we have a dance? We never did get around to doing that. I don't want to shake him, you know? What were you thinking? What in the world were you thinking?
The fence. I've been out there 4 times. They're taking visitors. That place has become a pilgrimage site. Clearly, that's a very powerful personal experience to go out there. It's so stark and so empty, and you can't help but think of Matthew there for 18 hours. 18 hours in nearly freezing temperatures with that view up there, isolated, and the whole God, my God, why have you forsaken me comes to mind.
Company member Greg Parati.
Filibri, friend of Matthew's, it took us to the fence this morning. I broke down the minute I touched it. I felt such a strong kinship with this young man. On the car ride back, I made sure that nobody saw me crying.
Lee Fonikowski. Greg was crying on the way back. I couldn't bring myself to tears, but I felt the same way. I have an interview this afternoon with Aaron Kreifels. He's the boy who found Matthew up there at the fence. I don't think I'm up for it. I'm gonna see if someone else can do it.
Well, I took off on my bicycle at around 5 o'clock p.m. on Wednesday from my dorm. Just kind of felt like going for a ride. So I went up to the top of Cactus Canyon, and I'm not super familiar with the area, so on my way back down, I didn't know where I was going. So I was kind of just picking a way to go, which, I mean, now looking back on it, it just makes me think that God wanted me to find him. Because there was no way I was going to go down that way, you know? So I was in some deep-ass sand, and I wanted to turn around, but for some reason I just kept going. So I went along, and there was this rock on the ground, this big rock, and I just drilled it. I went over the handlebars, and I ended up on the ground, you know? And I just brought myself up. I was dusting myself off, and I was looking around, and I noticed something, which ended up to be Matt just laying there by the fence, but I just thought it was a dummy. I thought it was a scarecrow. Honestly, it was around Halloween time. I thought it was a Halloween gag, so I didn't think anything of it. So I took my bike around to the other side of the fence. It was a bucktop fence, but the closer I got, the more I noticed his hair. Which was like a major key to me. Noticing that it was a human being was his hair. Because I thought it was a dummy. I saw his chest going up and down, but I still thought it was a dummy. I just thought that there was some sort of mechanism or something. When I saw his hair, that's when I knew it was a human being. So I ran to the nearest house. I ran as fast as I could, and I called the police.
I responded to the call.
Officer Reggie Flutie.
When I got there, the only thing I could see was partially somebody's feet, and then I got out of my vehicle and I raced over. I seen what appeared to be a young man, 13, 14 years old, because he was so tiny. Laying on his back, and he was tied to the end of a pole. I did the best I could. The gentleman that was laying on the ground, Matthew Shepard, he was covered in dry blood all over his head, and there was blood underneath him, and he was barely breathing. He was doing the best he could. I was gonna breathe for him, and I couldn't get his mouth open. His mouth wouldn't open for me. He was covered in, like I said, in dry blood and blood all over his head. The only place he didn't have any blood on him was on his face, where he appeared to have been crying. Right down his face. His head was distorted. It didn't look normal. He looked as if he had a really harsh head wound.
I was working the emergency room the night Matthew Shepard was brought in. I don't think that any of us can remember seeing a patient in that condition for a long time. Those of us who've worked in big city hospitals have seen this, but we have some people here who've not worked in a big city hospital, and it's not something you expect here. You expect to see this kind of injury from somebody going down a hill at 80 miles an hour. You expect to see gross injuries from something like that. This horrendous, terrible thing. But you don't expect to see it from someone doing this to another person. The ambulance said it was a beating, so we knew.
There was nothing I could do. Honestly, if there was anything that I could have done, I would have helped him, but there was nothing. I was just screaming at him from the top of my lungs, trying to get something out of him. Saying, hey, wake up, hello! But he didn't move. He didn't flinch. He didn't anything.
He was tied to the fence. His hands were thumbs out in what we call a cuffing position. You know, the way we handcuff people? He was bound with a really thin white rope about 4 inches up off the ground. His shoes were missing. He was tied, extremely tied. So I used my boot knife and I tried to slip it between the rope and his wrist. I had to be really careful not to harm Matthew any further.
Your first thought is, you'd like to think it's somebody from out of town that comes through and beats somebody. I mean, things like this happen. I know shit happens, and it happens here. But if there's been somebody who's been beaten repeatedly, certainly this is something that offends us. I think that's a good word for it. This offends us.
It was bound so tight. I finally got the knife. I'm sorry. We rolled him over onto his left side, and when we did that, he quit breathing. So immediately I put him back on his back, and that was just enough of an adjustment, you know, so I gave me room to cut him free there. Then I saw the EMS unit trying to get to the location, and once the ambulance got there, we put a neck collar on him and placed him on a backboard and scooted him from underneath the fence. Well, then Rob drove the ambulance over to Atkinson's emergency unit.
Now, the strange thing is, 20 minutes before Matthew came in, Aaron McKinney was brought in by his girlfriend. Now, I guess he had gotten into a fight later on in town or something like that. So I am working on him, and then the ambulance comes in with Matthew. Now, at this point, I didn't know anything about the connection at all. So I told Aaron to wait, and I went and started working on Matthew. So there's Aaron in one room in the ER, and then there's Matthew also in the ER, two doors down. Now, as soon as we saw Matthew, it was very obvious that his care was beyond our capabilities. So called the neurosurgeon at Poudre Valley, and he was on the road in an hour and 15 minutes, I think.
They showed me a picture. Days later, I saw a picture of Matthew. I never would have recognized him.
Then, 2 days later, I found out the connection, and I was very struck. These were two kids. They were both my patients, and they were two kids. I took care of both of them, of both their bodies. And then for a moment I wondered, is this how God feels?
when he looks down at us. I mean, we are all his kids. Our bodies, our souls. I felt a great deal of compassion for both of them.